Pastor James Coates was arrested and sent to prison a couple of weeks ago in Canada. What did he do? He held a church service.
When the pandemic began and all of the lockdown restrictions came in, by June of 2020, we were convinced it was time to open up. And that's when all the negative attention came. The community near us was making complaints about the size of our gatherings. That was bringing the attention of the health body that governs our province. So they were coming to our services and they were bringing the RCMP, our police with them. And we just stood where we were, drew the line in the sand and wouldn't budge. And that resulted in me ultimately being imprisoned. And folks need to understand, I could have just said, okay, fine, I'm ready to sign. And I would have been out, but I couldn't do that. Conviction wouldn't allow it.
Hey, and welcome to Zero Compromise, helping you stand for truth in a world that falls for lies. I'm Patricia Engler, joined here at the Ark Encounter by Jessica DeFord, aka JJ.
Hello.
And we don't have Rocket Rob with us, but we are so excited to interview the guests we do have. So what's going on, JJ?
We are absolutely honored. We have Pastor James Coates and his wife, Erin. Some of you might be familiar with the story of the persecution that he faced. He is the pastor of Grace Life in Edmonton. We're so excited for the conversation. Really looking forward to it.
Yeah, absolutely. So just to start us off, can you tell us both a little bit about your guys' backstory, how you became Christians, how God led you to church and the ministry you're doing?
So I didn't grow up in a Christian home, but I was saved at 23, so just 20 years ago, and was saved in an Alpha course. So that's where I heard the gospel for the first time and believed on Christ and received the forgiveness of sins. And then my wife and I met in October of 2005, and the rest is history on that.
That's awesome.
That was such a short testimony. Now the pressure's on.
Well, I heard in some other interviews that it was something about his calves.
Oh, that is hilarious. It was his shoes.
Oh, his shoes.
The first time I actually saw him, though, was his baptism. And I was like, oh, wow, that's the kind of man I want to marry. I was saved around the same time as him, around 23, and just lived an extremely immoral life, had a child outside of wedlock. I did grow up in a professing Christian home. I did grow up in the church and left that when I was 18, just got into a whole bunch of trouble and couldn't bear the weight of my sin on my conscience anymore. And so I had watched The Passion of the Christ one night and the Lord used that to save me. I saw a picture of the gospel and just the memories of everything I had been taught as a child. It was in there and confessed my sin and repented and turned to Christ. And that is the very, very short form version of my testimony.
Well, praise God. It's amazing to see how the Lord works in people's lives too, and how he takes brokenness and he redeems it. And then you walk in Christ and the sufficiency of Christ. So it's incredible. And you both are a testament to the power of Christ in that as well. So it's quite amazing. Can you share a little bit more about how you got plugged into ministry?
Well, I actually first sensed the desire to go into ministry at a leadership summit. It was actually, oddly enough, under the preaching of Bill Hybels, which is a little known fact, that I first sensed that desire to be used by God in a way that would go beyond me just normally doing a day job and that kind of a thing. Over time, that really crystallized as far as what the Lord was calling me to under the ministry of John MacArthur. And I really sensed a strong desire to preach the word. And it wasn't that I needed to be the one that was preaching the word, as though I had to be up at the front, as though I desired that. But I had a desire for the word to be preached, and I was seeing that it wasn't being preached. And so I just had a strong, compelling desire to meet that need for the building up of the body of Christ. And so that worked to me ending up at the Master's Seminary, where I was trained in how to handle the scriptures accurately. And so it's on the foundation of that training that I'm now in ministry in Edmonton, and just doing the regular routine of preaching God's word to God's people.
Yeah, for sure. So while you were doing that, something happened. So our theme of our podcast is living with zero compromise and standing on God's word. So you felt like you were being asked to compromise on what God's word says. So then what happened? What became of that?
Well, like many churches, when the pandemic began and all the lockdown restrictions came in, we opted to comply with most of what was being asked of us. And so we were limiting capacity and we went online and all of that kind of stuff. And we knew from the get-go, from day one, there was a tension here between Romans 13 and the need to gather, Hebrews 10:25. So we knew that there was an expiry date on this compliance. And so we just worked things out allowed the info to roll in to kind of assess the way the government was even handling COVID-19 and the severity of the virus and all of that. Plus, we were having time to kind of dot I's and cross T's on when it's time to defy the government. And obviously, we want to do that with a sense of sobriety. And so by June of 2020, we were convinced it was time to open up. And at that point in time, things were pretty smooth sailing until the fall of 2020, when they called the second public health emergency. And that's when all the negative attention came. We were meeting, the community near us was making complaints about the size of our gatherings. That was bringing the attention of the health body that governs our province. And so they were coming to our services and they were bringing the RCMP, our police with them. And so they're in our auditorium, on our balcony, both the police as well as AHS, just looking down on our gathering, counting heads and, you know, confirming that we're not complying with the Public Health Act. So that just was a saga that began where almost every single Sunday until I was in prison, they were in our building coming, you know, parked in our parking lot on Sundays. And it was an incredibly intense time. They used every avenue they could. They took us to court. The court ordered us to comply with their orders. We, you know, in fear and trembling, opted not to do that and to continue to meet. They used the court of public opinion and the media to just trash us and create all kinds of vitriol around us. And, you know, that wasn't going to affect us. And so they basically tried everything they could to get us to submit. And we were being respectful, but we can't comply. For us to continue to comply would have meant surrendering the headship of Christ to the government. And we just could not do that theologically, medically, scientifically, legally. We just checked every box, and there was no way that we could continue to comply and believe in our conscience that we were being faithful to Christ. So we just stood where we were, drew the line in the sand, and wouldn't budge. And that resulted in me ultimately being imprisoned.
Pastor James Coates was arrested and sent to prison a couple of weeks ago in Canada. What did he do? He held a church service.
And the way that went about is they didn't want me imprisoned. I mean, it wasn't like I was sentenced to prison. I was supposed to be released, but they gave me a condition, and the condition of release was that we comply with the Public Health Act. And I was saying, I can't do that. We've done this rodeo before. I can't comply with those terms. So then it's like, well, what do we do with him? You know, he's got to go somewhere. They can't release me. So that meant being in a maximum security prison for 35 days. And folks need to understand, I could have just said the word. I could have just said, okay, fine, I'm ready to sign. And I would have been out. But I couldn't do that. Conviction wouldn't allow it. It wasn't even a real temptation from one day to the next. And so the Lord just worked providentially to bring the government to the point where they were willing to modify the terms of my release so that I could be released with a clear conscience and then continue to do the work of pastoral ministry. And so I was able to get out and get back into ministry. Our first Sunday, they tried to get in our building again after not trying for 5 weeks while I was away. And we kept them out. Just said that based on our criminal code, they couldn't come in. Section 176 of our criminal code can't disrupt a service in progress. So anyway, they responded by later that week, breaking into our building, changing our locks, locking us out, put three layers of fencing around our facility and property. And then we went basically underground and we were just going here, there, and everywhere to worship the Lord under the blue sky. And some of the sweetest, you know, services we've ever had, to be honest with you. But we were just convinced that we needed to meet. And I think they all believed that we were going to be a part of this big protest. And there was a protest the first Sunday that we were locked out of our building, but we were actually at an undisclosed location worshiping Christ. And so I think they figured out that we aren't who they thought we were. And I think actually in the process of it all, we've garnered respect from our government, from law enforcement, even from many of the unbelieving community around us, that they realized, no, they're the real deal. And we weren't trying to showboat. We weren't trying to be cantankerous. We just had conviction. And we really believed that we did the best thing we could for our province.
Yeah, that's incredible. I just want to tell you guys, too, just a kind of a personal story of the fruit that came from your guys' faithfulness to Christ, too, that impacted me in my life. So I had left a church that I was in and ended up going down to the Founders Ministry Conference, and you were supposed to preach that year. And I was so excited. I really wanted to hear you preach, but you ended up not being able to come. They wouldn't let you cross the border. So then this guy, Don Green, was going to preach in your place. And I was like, Don Green, who's this Don Green guy? I don't want to hear this Don Green guy. So I was just grumbling in my heart about it. But then after Don Green preached, I was like, wow, I really like this guy. And I was looking for a church, and I ended up going to Truth Community Church where Pastor Don Green preached.
That's amazing.
Yeah. And so it so was good. The fruit that came out of your guys' faithfulness that led me to a new church. And I'm no longer at Truth because I got married, so I'm going to my husband's church now. Mm-hmm. But that was just a direct impact in my personal life from your guys' faithfulness to Christ. So I thank you for your faithfulness to Christ and the encouragement that it has had on the body of Christ and that impact.
Yeah, it's huge. And just so your people know too, not getting into the U.S. was not a Canadian thing. It was a U.S. thing.
Yeah,
so
right.
You guys had the longest standing vaccine mandate of, I think, any country in the Western world. And so it wasn't until March 2023 that I was able to come and be a part of anything happening on this side of the border.
Yeah. Well, we're definitely glad you're here now. So one thing I'm kind of curious is, as all this is happening, what was that like for you? Like, how did you support your husband going through that, knowing that he was heading to prison?
Yeah, I mean, there's so much going through your mind when that's happening. You don't really have an opportunity to look forward and go, you know, how do I plan this out? You have to live off of what you know about the Lord, which is why it's so important to know his word and to know him and to develop those convictions before something like this in your life happens. And I said it last night at the Essential Church, showing that after we had watched the premiere with Dr. John MacArthur, he had turned and he had said, like, people keep saying, like, you're so brave. And he says, it's not courage, it's conviction. And so when you have a conviction that's built off the word of God and is lived out in the power of the Spirit, you stand on that conviction. You're not having to scramble during those times to go, what do I believe? How do I honor Christ? All of that is already, the groundwork is already being laid. Now, he's obviously being gracious and teaching you things. And so there was a lot that he taught me about his character. But during that time, you know, I'm just doing what I've always done in serving my husband. I'm his Titus 2 helper, you know, Genesis 2, his rib, his helper. And so the way that I'm helping him in this circumstance is I'm trying to get him out of prison. And so I'm doing as many interviews as I can to get as much visibility, get the story out, because they were trying to silence us at that point. And so just getting as many interviews as I could get out. I'm working with lawyers, trying to put appeals through, anything that I can do to start to put pressure on our government to move the dial and to get him out. So that was pretty much my role. Well, you know, my children did such a good job of manning the house and taking care of all of the things that needed to be done in the home. Our oldest did all of his dad's jobs around the home. Our church took care of my meals so that I didn't have to worry or care about all of that stuff. So really it wasn't just James and I. There's a whole church standing behind us through this circumstance. So they were just amazing. So make sure that you're in a really good church, really good expository preaching Bible church that is going to care about your holiness, really elevates Christ in the gospel. And that's going to be easier to stand when the time comes. But my role didn't really change. I'm here to be his helper, and whatever that looks like in whatever season, that's what I have to do.
Yeah, praise God. You mentioned conviction, and I think there's a lot of Christians, especially who grow up in a Christian household and hear about the persecution of other Christians and think, oh, well, that's incredible that they were able to withstand that persecution or that they walked through that persecution, but they never really think about it hitting them themselves. And so we're called to love those who persecute us too. And I think there was a lot of responses that came out of that whole situation, and the way that you both responded to it, I think, was an amazing testament to those, to Christ and the Holy Spirit and all of that. So how can a Christian specifically, like, walk through persecution and have that conviction? And like, what scripture maybe helped you guys in that situation to stand on the authority of God's word and have that conviction in the midst of persecution while also loving those who persecute you?
Right. Did you want to answer that first, Henny?
Well, I think a gospel-centered life that is impacting your home, your relationship with your spouse, your relationship with your children, that's impacting your relationships in the body of Christ, a gospel-centered life is going to generate that. So if you're prone to bitterness, where you can see bitterness in your life in the context of your home and church, well, yeah, then when persecution comes, you're going to respond that way. But if the fruit of the Spirit is evident in your life and you understand that you are a sinner saved by grace, and you realize that Jesus says, blessed are those who are persecuted for his name's sake, then when that comes, you're not even really thinking about retaliating. You're just wanting to honor and glorify Christ in the midst of it. So I think just being gospel-centered and recognizing how much you've been forgiven, that your debt's infinite, and that's why it required an infinite price, and Christ paid that, and to realize that you have an eternity ahead of you, I think all of that fuels a graciousness toward people who wrong you.
Erin, do you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, I mean, I think you realize that you're dealing with people who are dead in their trespasses and sins, and that's exactly who you were before Christ transformed you and gave you a new heart and put his spirit within you. And so when you look at the people who are persecuting you or whatever they're doing, persecuting, insulting, saying all kinds of evil against you, this is exactly what Jesus said was going to happen. It happened with the prophets before us. So you expect it, but you have to really look at people like individual souls. And so as I realized the government, the police, whatever, my job, actually freeing James became secondary. Sharing the gospel became primary with all the opportunities I was getting through media, because how are people supposed to understand what we're doing if they don't understand who Christ is? And so when you look at that and how gracious and kind the Lord has been to you when you were yet his enemy and you hated him and you treated him the way that you did, you have to look at them like that. So that's been something that's been hugely disappointing to watch recently on social media, just the Christians who are really attacking the vile things that they say about each other and about governing authorities. Like, we're called to honor our governing authorities. Now, that doesn't mean that we don't tell the truth, because that's peace at all costs, right? Like, the Lord has come to bring a sword. But you just realize that, like, you have to treat them biblically and not in a way that's going to dishonor Christ. And so that's been hugely disappointing, to see that kind of behavior online, and just seeing that they need to still be holy while they deal with the people who are persecuting them. And I think 1 Peter 2 deals with how Jesus dealt with his persecutors who murdered him, and that he didn't revile against them and he was like a lamb to a slaughter. So he's our example for that. So when you have all of that in your mind, and it's not like you're not tempted to just, I can be very fiery. So I have to temper that.
That's true.
I have to temper that, and realizing it, and the Lord's giving you such grace in those moments to, when you're pleading with him, you know, I'm weak, I need to honor you, I need to treat these people as actual souls that are facing an eternity of hell. That helps you to see things a little bit differently. And so just recognizing that they need Christ, and I'm the person who's going to deliver that message to them. And if I'm being belligerent or I'm being cruel and attacking them and not their policies, that I probably won't have a clear conscience if I ever see them truly face to face, that I've put another stumbling block in front of them. The gospel's already a stumbling block. I don't want to be a greater stumbling block to that. So that was all the kind of stuff that was kind of going through my mind as we were facing all of it. It was very dark. It was so many attacks. The spiritual warfare that's surrounding it, you have to know God's word well to walk through something like that.
And let me say this. I mean, this is all about no compromise. It could be that there are some who believe that courage and conviction and boldness expresses itself in being belligerent, cantankerous, in fighting, and all the rest of it. And that's compromise as well. It's just compromise in a different area. And so I think, you know, Christ is the model. And if you wanted an earthly example of Christ where you have an individual who isn't truly God, truly man, you look to who? The Apostle Paul. He said, imitate me as I imitate Christ. So if you want someone to take your cue from in terms of how to live the Christian life, the Apostle Paul is the example. And so I think that's important for people to realize.
Yeah. So many good insights.
Absolutely. You guys both mentioned the gospel and a gospel focus. Can you real quickly, or maybe not real quickly, for our listeners who maybe don't know the gospel, can you share what the gospel is?
Yeah, the gospel is that we are born dead in our trespasses and sins, that we come into this world hostile toward God, slaves to sin. Sin has corrupted every aspect of our nature and being. And so we can do nothing that's pleasing to God. There's no way to earn his favor. And so God in his mercy and kindness, instead of leaving all of the human race in their sin, he commissioned his son into the world to take upon himself human flesh, to live a life under his law, fulfill it in every regard, being fully God, fully man, and to ultimately then go to the cross, where on the cross, it wasn't about the physical suffering so much. It wasn't about all that led up to the cross in terms of physical suffering. It was about God's righteous wrath and indignation being poured out upon Christ, where Christ would swallow up that wrath and offer himself as an atonement for sin, where he would then complete that satisfy the wrath of God for all that would ever believe on his name, die, giving up his own breath on his own authority, go into the grave, and on the third day rise again, proving he had conquered both sin and death, and then ascend to the right hand of the Father where he is now seated at his right hand, awaiting that time when he will return in judgment. And so now folks need to look to Christ. He is the only sacrifice for sin. He is the only atonement for sin. Folks need to turn from their sin, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and by turning from sin, believing on him, God reckons the sinner perfectly righteous, imputes the righteousness of Christ to their account, whereby they now have everything necessary to stand holy and blameless before God, sin forgiven, the hope of heaven, reconciliation with God, everything bound up in salvation, having been blessed with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. And then, you know, they're going to live for him. And I think that's important too, to highlight that with the gospel, you give up your life. Not only you're going to gain eternity, but you're going to lose your life now for his sake and walk in obedience to him, an obedience that he empowers you to walk in by his Spirit. You're going to be conformed and molded into his image, so becoming ever more like him in this life, and then ultimately the goal of it all, perfectly conformed into his image to be with him and behold his glory for all eternity.
There you go. Such great words. Thank you for sharing that. And I think what you're saying is really the answer to dealing with fear in the context of persecution, because we can be afraid of losing things that we think that we deserve here on earth, you know, comfort and freedom and things that we kind of expect. But if you have that gospel mentality and you know you've already given up your life, you only have Jesus to gain from that. So is there any other last words that you would want especially young people to know, or resources that you can point people to if they want to learn more about your stories?
Yeah, I think the best place to get a full appreciation for all that we went through is in the book called God versus Government, When Christ and Compliance Collide. And so that's a co-authored book, myself and Nathan Busnitz, and it tells the story of Grace Community Church and everything that John MacArthur and his church went through and their victory ultimately, as well as our story at Grace Life Church, step by step, and really models not just what happened in the context of our church and how we led our church through that, but even just personally takes you into some of the difficulties that I had as I was dealing with the prospect of jail and everything else. And so I think if folks want to just be more familiar with what happened, that would be the resource to get their hands on.
Yeah, we encourage all of our listeners definitely to check that out as a solid resource. And thank you very much, both of you, for coming on. And we really appreciate it.
Yeah, we really do. So I hope you are encouraged by that and that you really take those lessons to heart. Remember some of the things we talked about, drawing biblical boundaries ahead of time, getting to know God, attending a biblical local church, really hiding God's word in your heart so that when it comes, you're prepared and you've already committed to following Jesus without compromise in advance. So hope that encourages you, and please tune in next time. Meanwhile, we hope you keep standing on the truth of God's word with zero compromise.
See you guys later.